So thanks everybody for coming. This is the COC training for January 2018. We are going to be recording this, so if there's something that you miss or you want to listen again, we'll make that available probably next week before we're able to. I want to introduce our trainer this morning, and this is Howard Birchman. He is with Housing Innovations. And he's going to do a very interactive presentation, training for you. So if you have questions, feel free to ask as we go along. We will have lunch around noon. Just a couple other housekeeping items. There are restrooms. There's a men's room just right across the hall, and the women's is to the left. There's coffee and water, if you like that. We are going to keep the doors shut just so that we can kind of keep the noise down in terms of the recording. That's about it. So we'll get started.
Thank you very much, Jill. Let me, for those of you who are listening to this online, can I ask you to mute your microphones, because we are hearing some background noise from you, and it is a bit distracting. If you've got questions, unmute, and then we will hear your questions. But otherwise, we're hearing some other noise there. Hi, I'm Howard Birchman. As Jill said, I'm with Housing Innovations. It's really a pleasure to be with you here today. I think for the past two NOFA competition cycles, we've been working with the Indiana Balance of State, trying to assist you on that application process. As you know, the results came out last week. I think we all have a lot to be really happy about. How many of you got grants that were renewed in this past cycle? Everybody should be, because they all got renewed. Anybody here got a newly awarded grant in this cycle? There were. We had, like, I believe there were four newly awarded grants. We got our application had six bonus projects that were applied for. Three out of six bonus projects were awarded. We don't know the score yet, but obviously we got a pretty good score, because you don't get bonus projects funded in this competition unless you ended up with a pretty good score. The great news about getting additional bonus projects funded is that means that our annual renewal demand is going up. So, you know, the pie is getting larger, which is great, because one thing we certainly know, ending homelessness requires resources, and the more resources that we have, the likelihood is that we can have some greater success. It also requires us that we use our resources effectively and strategically, and talk a little bit about that today, because HUD is certainly trying to push us in that direction as well. Let me just get a little, I know there are a good number of people here and some people listening in elsewhere too, but let me just get some sense here as to what you all do. So how many of you folks here are most of your grantees, how many of you people were program folks where you're basically providing direct services to clients? Are others of you like more administrative folks who are doing more kind of contract compliance stuff? Some of you in that category? Anybody like in sort of the kind of property management sort of side as well? Right, okay. So we've got a good distribution of folks that are that are engaged in that in the process. And as Joe said, please, you know, I'm 100%, you know, stop me whenever you want, if you have questions. The goal is for you to have this information. Also, we'll find a way to get these slides, so you can all have these slides. If you want them, you can get more detailed content. You don't have to take as many notes. Also, for those of you who've got a computer or trying to connect to the Wi-Fi network here, you've got to do more than just log into the guest thing. Once you go, you've got to go to this the website, IVTechEDU is what you got to log into and accept the terms and conditions, so you're not going to get online unless you go to IVTech.edu and then accept their terms and conditions. Okay, and as Jill explained, well, in addition to the lunch break, we'll do like a 15-minute break in the morning and another 15-minute break in the afternoon. We're scheduled to be done by 4:30, I promise you. We'll be done no later than 4:30, and we may get done earlier. It'll depend a little on, you know, if you've got a lot of questions and stuff like that, we're here to be here and address those questions. Oh, and it works so well. It works so well. Okay.
Wow, that's high.
I wonder what happened.
Oh, you can't. Seriously?
It looks like
people on the phone still can't hear what's happening.
Right.
Okay. We'll see what's going on. So a couple of things we're going to talk about here. One, I want, you know, among the things that are the really important takeaway things is we're really getting funds from the federal government to prevent an asbestos. This is a great thing and is an essential thing. But we want to be sure, you know, once you're recipients of federal funds, there are certainly a lot of conditions associated with that. And they are here to expend, especially these HUD funds, on behalf of people who are eligible for these services, or providing funds for activities that are not specifically eligible under the continuum care regulations, doing those things, serving people who are ineligible, doing things that are not listed as specifically eligible activities under the CRC regulations, or engaging in activities that are not specifically listed in your contract with HUD, doing any of those things. Assuming that you did not do that with a fraudulent or criminal intent, HUD is going to say, that's fine. You just need to give us back all the money that you spent either on behalf of an ineligible participant or on ineligible activities or on things that were not included in your contract. HUD does do this. If you've got permanent supportive housing and you do not have documentation in your file that shows that that household met the definition of a disabled household, HUD says, that's okay. You just give us every dollar that you gave in assistance to that family back to us, and you wire transfer it back to the federal treasury. They'll tell you the account number you wire transfer those funds back to. I have seen this happen to nonprofit organizations who did not have those disability and went back a couple of years. We could be talking about tens of thousands of dollars that one could be liable for, because you can't provide assistance on behalf of somebody unless you really documented that they're eligible for this assistance. HUD is serious about this. If they monitor and find that, they have no choice. This is not to scare folks, it's just we have to make sure that our participant files have got the information that they have to have in there, because if they don't have it in there and HUD comes to monitor you, send us the money. They've got a simple answer to their problems. You don't want to send that money back. I can assure you there is no nonprofit provider that I know, a home services provider, that can just easily write a check, a very large check back to the federal treasury. It's not something you want to have happen, not something that's going to be good for your organization. So that's what I'm trying to do, is to make sure that's not going to happen to you. Or if it happens to you, you're going to know that you're at risk of that happening to you, so you're not blindsided by that potential risk. So we'll talk about participant eligibility. We're also talking about HUD very much, and this is a real kind of a challenge, because a lot of you may have had your grants for a good number of times. I've been working on these continuum, well, used to be, as you know, got away, supportive housing, shelter plus care before those days. I've been working on them since this program started. There are these grants that are 30 plus years old, in there, and a lot of times HUD has changed the rules over those 30 years, and a lot of times people have been working based on what they did 10, 15 years ago and stuff like that, and don't necessarily have the speed about changes in it. Again, HUD doesn't care about that stuff. It's, you know, incumbent upon grantees to be on top of these changes in the regulation. Okay. So a lot of what HUD is talking about doing, especially when we're talking about permanent supportive housing, but we know with coordinated entry and things like that, we're talking about prioritizing the systems that we have and not necessarily moving away from what we did, first come, first serve. Basically, you know, who's ever on the waiting list, that's the way we use Section 8 for all our housing assistance. HUD says for homeless assistance, we don't work that way anymore. We basically want to make sure that we're prioritizing those who are chronically homeless, that have got the greatest needs, so to make sure that those are the folks who get the assistance first. That's based on research. The research tells us that there is, that's where we came with the whole chronic homeless thing, that there is a small, relatively small number of folks who consume extremely high levels of services. If we can target assistance to those folks, we can have really disproportionate levels of impact. That's what we're trying to do through prioritization and coordinating.
Thank you.
Thank you again. And then we'll also talk about some of HUD policies that are coming in. There are a number of changes, especially with respect to, and I know you've got other training and stuff like that, I won't go great detail on it, but there are new requirements, especially for legislation like the Violence Against Women Act. There are new equal access rules and stuff like that that HUD has established, and it's important that we stay up to speed on these protections. We'll also talk about, you know, some of the specific nitty-gritty program requirements, and then, okay, it's working again, yay. And how to do it. Now, you all, do you have any sense? I mean, you all came here, took time out of your day. I think you were kind of told you had to come to this training. Did anybody have a sense as to what you want, what you would like to know, have accomplished at the end of today?
I think just the general updates would be good for me. I feel like a lot of times our information comes
out really haphazardly.
Great.
And so it's hard to grab from one source to another source and
stuff
like that. So we can just get an overview.
Super.
That's fine.
Great. That very well. Yeah. All right. That's a good sentiment. Let's go. Let's keep going here. So I want to, in addition to, you know, I'm going to dive a lot into the nitty-gritty of the regulations, but I think it's important to keep some of the overall context in mind as to what we're working toward. So obviously, HUD's biggest priority is we're really talking seriously about trying to end homelessness for all folks. We want to, and as we're slowly doing, you know, HUD has a lot of this process of reallocation where we can take funding that's currently coming into the continuum care and reprogram it. A lot of, you know, in this year, especially in the Indiana and a balance of state, a lot of what we want to look at is underspending, because there's no doubt, I mean, this continuum care, every continuum care is every year sending quite a bit of money back to HUD because of unspent grants. And what we want to do, obviously, is minimize the extent to which that is happening. Either have folks fully spend down their grant, or if they can't do that, let's acknowledge that, and let's find those dollars and reallocate it to use them to create some new projects elsewhere to serve folks in the COC. I was just doing this training in New York City last week. New York City each year sends back $8 million in grants from the federal treasury, which is like about two-thirds of all the money that we get here in the state of Indiana. They just waste, but, you know. It's not wasted, it gives tax breaks to billionaires. But we think that there's another use for those dollars. And we want to see those dollars serve the people who have the greatest need in this community. So we're going to have a big theme here about trying to identify where there is underspending. And if there's underspending, you want to know what's going to happen. You either want to do a grant, if you need to do a grant amendment to move it to somewhere else in your budget that will align, you can spend it. Great, let's get on that early in the year so we can make that happen. Or if you can't do that, let's identify those funds and allow other providers or even your own organization to direct those funds to another purpose where we can really use those funds. Okay, we do want to measure our system performance. I'm going to talk about those system performance measures in just a minute, but HUD is very clear. As we go through this competitive cycle, the thing that they're really going to be looking at is the extent to which we are showing progress on the system performance measures. HUD is not saying we necessarily have to compare what our COC is doing to every other COC in the country. What we want to do is compare our year-over-year performance and see if we're making progress on these system measures. And, you know, when we go over them, I think they are actually a very reasonable set of measures that, you know, if we are able to accomplish these goals, we really will have some meaningful impact in reducing the impact of homelessness. We know the requirement is that coordinated entry be implemented by, I think it's January 23rd, and it says like the 18th, so we got three or four more days to do this. I mean, everybody says, okay, how are they are supposed to do something on the 23rd to tell them that we're up in, who knows? We don't know that yet. We assume that in the application process that we're gonna go through for the 2018 NOFA, HUD is gonna ask in great detail about the status of our coordinated entry, but basically, it's here, it's on the horizon. And really, what this is gonna tell us is that rather than each provider deciding who it is that they're going to serve basically independently, you know, they're going to get referrals from a coordinated system, and those referrals are again going to be sending folks who've got the highest priority needs for folks. And it may mean for some programs that were not initially serving that very, very high need population are going to be serving, you know, more challenging, more sick people with much more severe service needs than they have been in the past. That is what coordinated entry should be resulting in. Other thing is, of course, we want to look at our outcome data to improve our expenditure forces, funds. We always want to use, when we can, mainstream resources because we know the homeless dedicated resources are so limited, so we want to maximize that. We want to use a housing first approach, and we're going to talk about that a little. I mean, we know that because we reviewed the applications, and I think everybody in this continuum of care on their HUD application indicated their project was following Housing First. It is very easy to say those two words, Housing First. It is very, very, very challenging to actually implement a program that is fully based on Housing First. We want to talk a little bit about that and the challenges and why it's an important way to approach this thing. We want to, again, get people into housing as quickly as possible. That is HUD's goal. We're moving away from where we used to be, where we thought that people had to go through a period of transitional housing or other services in order to become housing ready and skilled enough to be able to occupy permanent housing. Now we believe what we need to do is get people in permanent housing and provide them the wraparound supports they need to be able to sustain that housing on a long-term basis. Obviously, that means when we are dealing with housing that we do not own or ourselves, and a lot of our permanent support housing is owned by the providers, but certainly when we're working with third-party landlords, we need their participation, we need their engagement in order to be able to work with our tenants. Housing First really is based on the notion that we're going to have a property owner that is enforcing the obligations of tenancy. All too often, we have set up different standards for people coming out of homelessness. We say, well, okay, you know, we'll allow you to do things differently than we demand on other tenants in the community, and I think that's doing a disservice to folks. What Housing First is, we use the same rules for everybody in the community. You know, I'm lucky, I'm a homeowner, but you know, if I don't meet my mortgage payments, if I don't keep my insurance current, if I don't do those other things, I'm not gonna be a homeowner. You know, things are going to go wrong for me, you know, if I'm a tenant. You know, it doesn't matter whether I'm formally homeless or anything like that, unless I pay my rent, you know, unless I do not move, you know, 16 people who are unrelated into that unit, if I'm partying all night long, it don't matter. If I'm not a homeless tenant, I'm going to lose that unit. And people need to understand those rules, because it's really the same rules for everybody in the community. As long as they can follow the rules of a lease, they will have the skills that they need to be able to live independently. And a lot of the times people say, the lease really does give you, the lease is the program. Because, I mean, frankly, if you've got issues with folks, if it's issues on substance use and things like that, it's really going to show up as in terms of a violation of the obligations of tenancy. They're not going to be paying their rent. They are going to be partying. There are going to be people in the unit who are not supposed to be in the unit. This is how these issues are going to emerge. And we're going to address those issues as basically as lease violations and teach people about what the obligations of tenancy are and how they can maintain that lease so they can stay there.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Howard. I'm getting word from my staff that they still cannot hear. The sound is muffled coming in and out and is very low. So I don't know if there's a microphone that you can use.
Okay, so I'll try standing more in oh, will this help? Yeah, I can turn around. I can do all kinds of things. Let's. All right.
Hey, just a sec. All right. We'll see if that works better for the folks listening at home. It seemed to?
I'm gonna text.
Okay. Good. All right. Well, I will use this. Okay. I've hit that. So I mentioned about the system performance measures, and obviously, the length of time that people are homeless is a real issue. Homeless is in and of itself a traumatic experience for folks who want to lessen that trauma, and want to get people out of homelessness and into housing as quickly as possible. Again, it's going to be measured not necessarily compared to how quickly people in San Francisco get moved from homelessness and housing. We're going to look year after year and see if we can reduce the length of time that people are homeless in this community. Obviously, if we place people in permanent housing, the goal is for them to remain in permanent housing. So if people go from permanent housing back to homelessness, it really sort of raises questions about the significant investment that we did in that permanent housing resource. And so clearly what we want to accomplish is not have people return from homelessness after we place them in permanent housing. We know the overall number of homeless people is really important. HUD, as we know, they just released it from last year. Yes, still bad?
Yeah, that didn't fix it. I'm guessing it's not the mic that's the problem. I don't know what's...
So maybe I go closer to this? Is if I kind of keep myself more stationary over here, is this... Because this is, in theory, where it's coming from. This is the speaker thing. All right, I'll try and stand up here, and we'll see what happens. So I talked about that. Meanwhile, number of homeless persons, this is next week, right? We've got the PIT count coming up next week. It is vitally important that we have an accurate and a good PIT count. That is going to, the information that we have there is going to be really important. Not only that, you know, we also have the housing inventory chart that's going to be coming up. That's something we need to look at very, very, very carefully, especially because, you know, when we're making sure that, and we did a merger in the COC last year, so we need to do a little look at what we are listing in the housing inventory chart to make sure those really are homeless dedicated resources that we are listing there in the housing inventory chart. Especially when you look over the application from last year, I think the application was really, really good, but we did have a number of areas, and HUD scores this about HMIS coverage, and a number of the unit types in the housing inventory count did not have high HMIS coverage. So we want to make sure, something we want to take a look at, because we are losing some points in that area. And on top of that, if we don't have good HMIS coverage, that means our data is not of the highest quality that we want to have as well. So that is important. Obviously, jobs and income growth for people who have experienced homelessness is extremely important. Jobs, employment does all kinds of stuff. As those of you who are working, especially with chronically homeless folks, I'm sure you deal with this on a daily basis. If we take people who are living homeless, is living in a state of crisis, your days are very full when you're homeless because survival is basically your full-time job, your full-time activity. When we place people in permanent housing, we take all of that away from them, which is a good thing because that is really crisis living. But people need to learn how to adjust from living a life in crisis to one that involves much more structure and purpose and planning associated with it. And if we don't help people find meaningful things to do with their days now that they're no longer engaged in a constant battle for survival, they will find other ways to occupy their days. And the other ways that they're occupying their days are not always going to be helpful for housing stability. So if we can have folks with employment, it gives them a role in life. That's their job, and that's an important thing. Because no one in this planet identifies as being a homeless person. No one does. And helping people have more of a role is hugely important. Also, of course, it gives people income, which is essential. And it gives them something to do with their days. So paid employment is great. Volunteer activity is great, again, because it gives people some structure, some purpose, something to do with their days. People who have none of that are lost. Sometimes when they get totally lost, they turn day into night, and they're up all night, and it's disturbing the neighbors. These are all things that get in the way of housing stability. So the extent to which we can have other stability is essential. Of course, it's not all about jobs and certainly mainstream benefits. Making sure that people get access to the benefits and support that they are eligible for is also going to be extremely beneficial for them. We don't want people to enter the homeless system for the first time. It really talks about our prevention efforts in the community. That's a really challenging thing for folks. And we want to move as many people as possible from homelessness into housing. Okay, I mean, I think we know this sort of overall background and the system performance measures. So let's get into some of the nitty-gritty. Now we are, by the way, still under what HUD calls the interim regulations. So the regulations for the continuum care program are not what they call final. They are going to reopen these regulations for comment sometime in the not too distant future. Understand that if there's anything in the regulations that doesn't make sense to you, does not work for your program, HUD makes it clear the only way they can ever change those regulations once they've issued them is based on comment they receive from the public. So if there's anything about the regulations, I mean literally, that don't work for you, when they reopen the comment period, it really is incumbent upon one to write to HUD and say, this is what really needs to be changed about this regulation. In the absence of them getting that feedback, there is no way they can make a change to the regulation. So just as a little tip there, it is going to be opened up. But meanwhile, until it is regulations are changed, they are enforced, and you have to spend your dollars consistent with these regulations. So let's talk about eligibility. I alluded to this before. I mean, you cannot serve people who are not eligible for assistance. If it is a dedicated chronically homeless bed, you cannot serve. So even if you're serving people who are homeless, if they do not meet the chronic homeless definition, it's the same as if you were serving somebody who didn't even meet the homeless definition. They're not going to be eligible for that. And if HUD comes in and monitors you, and it's a dedicated bed, chronically homeless bed, and that's not a chronic homeless household occupying that unit, big trouble. So let's talk about this stuff. So we know HUD believes that homeless people are like hurricanes and storms and things like that. And we can give categories of homelessness. I don't necessarily agree with categorizing people in different units, but this is what we do here. So we have category one, homeless people. These are folks who are literally homeless. We know that people are in shelters, people who are living unsheltered, people who we count, you know, on the point in time count as being homeless. They are eligible for permanent support housing. They're eligible for rapid rehousing. They're eligible, and we have very little left in the COC, but they're eligible for transitional housing as well. Category two, these are the folks who are imminently at risk of homeless, but they are not literally homeless. This is sort of, we all know this, this is kind of the cool thing of HUD homeless assistance spending, right? We know that there are many, 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 many people who are homeless, but we don't count them as homeless in our system because HUD is very, very strict in terms of this literal homeless definition. We know there are many households that are double, tripled up, quintupled up. People are living in other people's homes because they don't have a home of their own to live in. On the educational side, we consider those folks in that situation to be homeless. On the HUD side,
cruel as it is, we do not consider those folks to be literally homeless. And although they have this category definition of imminent risk, and if you're going to lose your housing within 14 days and you've got no other supports or resources in the community, you could qualify for some assistance. It is very, very, very limited assistance. For the most part, everybody that we're going to be serving through our continuum care funded programs is going to either meet the definition of literal homeless or going to be people who are deviant, who are fleeing the violence of a domestic violence situation. Those are the populations that we're overwhelmingly going to serve. If you're serving anybody else, it could be high risk. There is this third category that I just talked about, is the people who would be homeless under other federal definitions, which is basically that population of people who are living doubled up. HUD says you need special permission from HUD to serve that population. As of this date, they have not granted that special permission to anybody in the United States. So no one in America is serving this Category 3 with HUD continuum care funds, homeless folks. So we're clear about this. You know, it's really literally homeless or DD people overwhelmingly that we're going to be serving through our programs. Again, coordinated entry is really limited. Those are the referrals that you should be receiving. And of course, we get all these things.
I think we even have a restriction at the COC level, right? It's just 1 in 4.
Yeah.
We don't allow tune for anything.
I'm sorry, I was trying to deal with the webinar.
The question was, it is. I think, because I don't think Category 2 is going to be. Right. First of all, we don't have transitional housing, right? That sort of had a.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Prevention, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we actually restricted it.
Yep.
To 1.
Good.
And it's, you know, I mean, obviously, you know, this is a little bit of homeless folks, and obviously people who are of shelter transition.
In the unusual, sometimes there are some hotel, motel vouchers in rural areas and stuff like that that are used in lieu of shelter.
That's going to qualify as being literally homeless.
There isn't a safe haven here either, so
that's not going to count either.
You understand that there is, when they changed the regulations, they did allow, you know, for a little leeway for people who are leaving institutions only for a short period of time, as long as they're in institutional care for under 90 days, and they were homeless prior to entering that institution, they're going to maintain that homeless status. When we get to the chronic homeless definition and counting up the days to be chronically homeless, that allowance for folks exiting institutions comes into play, because it helps us to come up with the number of days that we need to meet the chronic homeless definition. But again, in order for them to maintain that eligibility, if they're exiting institution for less than 90 days, and jails definitely qualify. You know, so people, as long as they're jailed for less than 90 days, that's still going to qualify. And they were homeless prior to being incarcerated, they're going to maintain that homeless status when they were released from that. Disability. Now, this is important because in order to be a resident in permanent supportive housing, the household must be homeless and disabled, right? And in order to be a chronically homeless household, you've got to have the head or the co-head of the household be a person with disabilities, as well as being a long-term homeless person. And there are multiple definitions of disability within the federal government. We are on the HUD side for the most part, so we can pay most attention to the HUD definition of disability. This is it listed here. It includes, as you can see, an impairment caused by alcohol or drug abuse, PTSD, or a traumatic brain injury. HUD's keywords are long continuing or indefinite duration, so disabilities do not come and go. It basically should be there for the long term. It impedes the person's ability to live independently and can be improved by more suitable housing accommodations. If you have someone who is licensed by the state of Indiana to diagnose and treat a condition, they are able to verify the disability. So that is, if you've got a licensed social worker and you've got a mental health or even a substance use disorder, that licensed social worker is capable of making the disability determination because they're licensed by the state to diagnose and treat that condition. If you've got a medical condition, you're going to need an MD. If you ever get, I mean, obviously, getting a disability certificate signed by an MD is always the great thing to do. It's sort of like the gold standard. But any professional who is licensed to diagnose and treat can make this disability determination. But what I will say is that anybody in permanent supportive housing in their file must have a disability determination in that file. It must be there. It either is going to come in the form of if they're receiving benefits from the Social Security Administration, either supplemental security income or SSDI, Social Security Disability Income. If you've got documentation that they're receiving those benefits, they are considered to be disabled. Either a copy of that benefit check will show that they're disabled. If there's a determination letter from Social Security, that will qualify them as being disabled. So you don't need, if you've got that from Social Security, you do not need to do a belt and suspenders. You do not need to get an independent verification if Social Security has determined them disabled. If you do not have that Social Security, then you've got to get an independent thing. And I see that there's some faces. So are there some questions about this?
This is like the hardest paper ever to get signed by any doctor or nurse practitioner or anything like that. But going back, you were saying that we can use a licensed social worker?
Absolutely. Not for medical conditions.
Not in Indiana.
I was going to say,
Indiana has a law that doesn't allow social workers to do that.
It specifically says on our paperwork that we cannot use.
Yes,
yeah,
it's
an
Indiana law.
Right.
Not even, I think it's...
That's like a state law. Because, I mean, can't social workers die? I mean, social workers can treat mental health issues.
They can't prescribe. So we have to go for like a psychiatrist or an MD or a nurse practitioner or anything like that, but we cannot use. So that would be like awesome if we could, but I'm pretty sure that it says on our paperwork.
Yeah, it's on the Indiana level, though. It's not HUD.
It makes it really difficult because we're bringing in.
Is that something you can look?
Yeah.
I think we should look. So maybe
is it
a COC? Who's
for
that?
That's state regulation.
I was trying to run it to show you. Well, we gotta take a look. That's.
I'll probably pull it up.
Well, Jill sends it out. She just sent it out. Not so
much. Yeah, I'm gonna tack off here just one second. So the folks that are on the line are still having a lot of trouble. I'm sorry to. So we're going to go ahead and end that, the GOTA meeting. And because we're recording it, we'll make sure that you get the link to the recording at a later point. But we just seem to be having too many technology issues. And so I do apologize to everyone on the phone. We will make sure that we send the webinar live actual production to you at a later point. So please accept my apology. This seems to be an IV check kind of issue. So my apologies. So I'm going to go ahead and we'll end the webinar part of it or the meeting part, and then we'll make this available probably next week.
Okay, I'm sorry to hear that. And I guess I'm getting the opportunity to learn too.
It's just something that, like, I've had a lot of problems with
yeah,
right now.
Yeah, sure. And on top of that, again, you know, as I said, if you've got Social Security documentation, you don't need a letter.
But most of our people, I mean, coming from practically homeless, this is what I'm running into.
I know that to start the whole process,
right.
And the whole store thing, and get the whole process.
And get somebody in an apartment within like 30 days is like crazy sometimes. To get all, like, this is the paper that holds up right here. Because MDs don't want to sign the paper because they've never been about this person before.
I know.
They're afraid it's connected to Social Security somehow. And then you have to approve to them. This is not a Social Security paper. This is a verification of disability for this HUD program for housing.
Yeah.
And even if you go through every word on there like that, they still won't sign it.
I mean, it's not 100% rational, but I sure understand that. I've certainly seen that dynamic. That's why we use social workers so much everywhere in 49 states. I'm so sorry. We'll look into whether there's anything, maybe it's a state thing that there's nothing to be done about. I mean, what I can unsay is that we do need a disability verification in everybody's file. If they get the permanent support of housing, we absolutely have to have that disability verification.
Does the disability documentation need to state what the disability is for?
No.
Okay.
No, and on top of that, you know, this we want to be careful about some sort of HIPAA-related stuff, too, because you guys do not want confidential medical information. We do not need a diagnosis. We just need a verification of these things, and frankly, a lot of times, the diagnosis is not helpful, because then it starts to be protected medical information that we don't want. Go ahead.
But it does need to be a disability that's been a barrier to housing. For example, I work in permanent supportive housing for veterans, and so I come across a lot of veterans that maybe have a 10% disability for tinnitus, but when you talk to them, that's not the disability that led to their homelessness. it's been addiction issues or chronic and severe mental health issues. So then I usually make sure that I have a form signed, and I don't use their VA disability because that's verifying their tinnitus, and that's not the
correct. It just needs to say those three things up there.
Yeah, exactly.
Right there. If you can get a doctor to check those three things off, you're good.
You know, the VA, what they're talking about is service. That when you're talking about temporary, you're talking about service-connected disabilities, and the VA has got a very complex system for making this determination as to whether people, you know, had a disability and the connection between that disability and their military service. And that's what qualifies them for certain levels of VA pension. What generally happens, by the way, is that people who end up with 100% service-connected disability, which some veterans do have, it makes them overincome for Section 8, for example, so they can't participate in HUD DASH and things like that, even though they don't have much money, but still, it's enough to go over the very low income thing. So, yeah, it is a slightly, but the VA thing is a slightly different thing than this. It really, the HUD disability is really these things that really is all about being long continued, and that, you know, it makes it difficult for them to otherwise maintain housing. We'll come back to this one. That's upsetting. And then everything goes wrong. Come on. All right. Oh, so we're talking about. So I think we hit all this stuff. Obviously, that license by the state to diagnose and treat, except I guess in Indiana, but having really high license. But again, from SSA or those disability check. There is this thing, by the way. The regulations allow the staff to visually observe the disability and then later get the documentation on it. Needless to say, be very, very careful about using that option. I would say the only time you want to use it if you got like a clearly physically handicapped person, you know, clearly, you know, I mean, even the Section 8 regulations and stuff like that, they make it very clear. You know, if a person is blind, you know, we don't make people jump through hoops to demonstrate or document their disability. So if it's readily observable by folks, it is readily observable. And then you could potentially backfill with that documentation later on. But obviously, you always want to be careful about not having the fully documented file when you start making assistance payments, because if you don't get that documentation, HUD will ask for the money back.
Howard. I'm sorry to ask you, but is the 45 days on the observation, is that from the moment of housing or from the moment of intake into the program?
Intake into the program, yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yep. Once you firmly admit it, and then basically are starting the process of providing assistance benefits to them, either, you know, staff benefits or
like housing search and all that stuff.
So chronic homeless, we know 2 years ago, they kind of tweaked the chronic homeless definition. They are very literal and very strict about this definition. It is complex. It can be very complex. So obviously, in order to be chronically homeless, you first have to start out by being literally homeless, and so therefore living, you know, in category one homelessness to begin with. And be literally homeless for a long period of time. You know, if it is 12 months of continuous homelessness, it's easier. The record keeping is a lot easier. They always had the concept within the chronic homeless definition of the four whatever of and HUD uses all these different language to say, I mean, is it an episode of homelessness? They started calling it spells of homelessness. They call it all kinds of craziness. I mean, you know, horror, periods of horror in people's life is what the hell it is. And let's not euphemize it into a spell or an occasion or an episode. So you have to have four episodes of stickiness within a 3-year period of time. Now, that had always been the case, but, you know, then HUD got concerned because people could basically have 5 days homeless over 3 years, and it's sort of meeting the chronic homeless definition. That's not what they wanted to be the case, so they tightened it. So basically, those four times homeless have gone to total up to 365 days in that 3-year period of time. Now, what is sort of anally compulsive on their end is they literally mean four. So if you had somebody who had two episodes of homelessness that total up to 365 days, that ain't gonna count. There's gotta be four. Which is Meshuggah in my book, but it's also the rule. It really is the rule. There is some good, so that means if you don't have those continuous
those 365 continuous days of homelessness, you have got to demonstrate that there were periods of homelessness, breaks in that homelessness, and a break is defined as 7 days or more of not being homeless, and then the return to homelessness in that period of time. The only thing that is good is HUD allows you to self-certify breaks in homelessness. So if, as long as you've got documentary evidence of those 365 days, either from HMIS or some other kind of record, you can allow the participant to say, oh, I lived at my sister's house for a week in the month of March 2017, or I lived with, you know, on my brother's couch for 8 days in February. They can just say that you have to put that statement in the file, and then you will show that you have that break. And you've got to have those breaks as well. You know, you've got to have at least 3 breaks in order to get 4 occasions. It's crazy, but they are really strict about that, and they're going to look for it. And obviously, as we indicated, in order for it to be a chronically homeless household, the head or the co-head of the household has got to be a person with disabilities. Obviously, if it's a single person in the household, that person has got to be disabled. The important point is, although a minor could qualify a family as being a disabled family, if that minor has a disability, a minor with disabilities is not going to qualify the whole family for chronic homeless status. It's got to be the head or the co-head. Basically, when you've got a chronically homeless family, what you need to document is that the head of the household meets the chronic homeless definition and has met that chronic homeless definition. You don't have to worry about documenting the other household. I mean, if you can, that's fine. HUD recognizes that in families there can be change in family composition, and so it doesn't matter if every sibling or everybody else or every child in the household was necessarily homeless for that same period of time. As long as the head of the household met that chronic homeless definition, those family members who are with him or her will need it. Yes, sir?
You mentioned that breaks can be self-certified.
Yes.
How much of the homeless history can be self-certified?
We're going to get into that. Thank you. Good question. There is some, and we'll get into that. Go ahead.
Number two, having a 1 year continuous day that contradicts the whole idea of 90 days of institutionalization. We serve women with serious chronic mental illness, and they may be hospitalized for more than a year, which means they're not considered homeless, right? Or need to be less like.
Yes, because HUD would say, you know, that's this whole discharge thing. And, you know, HUD is going to say those other systems of care should not be discharged. You know, you should basically have a discharge term proposing, should not be just releasing folks. I mean, is it inpatient center?
Where they're hospitalized?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
and,
I mean,
and it may take them over years to be ready to go into supported housing.
Yes. And then HUD would say then the mental health system should be providing some kind of accommodations to allow people to leave that institutional care, and saying that's not what they're trying to say. I mean,
have you met any of our residents? No, I'm just curious on why that's.
It's just that, I mean, it's their fear that if they basically say anybody can come out of any system of care, foster care, you know, psychiatric hospitalization, or you know, the long-term incarceration, and that becomes, you know, HUD's responsibility to house them all into a homeless system. We'll never have the resources to do it. That's why, but it's cruel. I mean, these things are cruel because all these people are in intense need. I mean, you know, it's cruel. They all need them. I do get that. Let me get, we want to get the self-certification stuff. Okay, so a couple of things here. Yes, again, you can, the same thing about those, if you were literally homeless, and then you go for the under 90, sorry, what they call the good kind of institutionalization, the under 90 days stuff. Those days, as long as, you know, if I go from a shelter and then I go into the hospital, as long as I leave on my 89th day, all those 89 days will count towards my period of time homelessness, and you can count that towards chronic homeless status as well. So you can count those institutional stays towards as homeless time, as long as they were homeless before they entered that institution. And it will count if you have, sometimes there, a couple things can happen. Either there isn't a permanent supportive housing unit available, and coordinated entry will happen in the future, may make a referral for a family that we're pretty confident is going to need permanent supportive housing, but we don't have a unit, so people can be placed in rapid rehousing
As long as you document prior to entering that rapid rehousing that they were chronically homeless, if they need, before they exit from that rapid rehousing, if they need more services than we can provide through rapid rehousing, they would be eligible to move from that rapid rehousing to permanent supportive housing. They will retain their chronic homeless status during their period in rapid rehousing.
Yeah.
If you've documented that somebody, if you've got a rapid rehousing program, and when that household enters the program, you document that they meet the chronic homeless definition, and then it's some months into the rapid rehousing, so there are two scenarios. One, you could, to keep that household from being homeless, place them in that rapid rehousing while you wait for a PSH unit to become available. That's allowable. Or number two, you could recognize, because this happens, the assessment was not as good as it could be, and it turns out that person has got, is not going to be able to maintain it, after 6 months, 8 months, 9 months of assistance. They're going to need permanent assistance. Then we can transfer them into permanent supportive housing, because we recognize that, they really need more help and support than we can provide on an interim basis. We're still working on the self-certification. I've not forgotten that. As I said, occasionally you've got to create this break, at least for a break in homelessness, it's got to be at least 7 days to qualify as a break. Sometimes, especially, clearly if people are in a shelter, if their information is in HMIS, it's a lot easier to work with, but there aren't going to be unsheltered folks. And those unsheltered folks may be being encountered by outreach teams and things like that, and we can use that as documentation. HUD makes it clear, an outreach worker does not need to see somebody being homeless every day of a month. If the outreach worker has encountered that homeless person at any time during the course of that month, that entire month counts as a month being homeless. You do not need to have day-by-day diary of where folks are. I'm going to get into my self-certification, I really will. But this, HUD keeps issuing these order of priority things that they are saying, and basically, what they're saying, and while we're doing our assessment, we use the DISCADAP, right, as our assessment thing. So basically, we want to be looking at folks who've got the longest histories of homelessness and the most severe service needs. Basically, serving the chronic first, we're gonna serve chronic first, then on that wonderful day when we run out of chronic homeless people in the community, we'll be able to serve folks who don't meet the chronic homeless definition according to this order of priority. As you can see, wherever you turn, HUD likes to put transitional housing at the bottom of the list. They do everything they can to make transitional housing as a less attractive option for COCs. So the lowest priority for folks on the prioritization of folks coming out of transitional housing. Go ahead.
For the institutions, the less than 90 days, would we mock that? Sorry, last slide. But then we mock that up as, would that be a break?
No, that would be considered, that would count towards time homeless.
Would the 90 days count, or just the time prior to?
No, the 90 days, the 89 days.
Thank you.
Would count, yes, you can count them towards the 365.
Okay.
And that's not considered a break, that is considered literally homeless as well, as long as they were literally homeless prior to entering that institution. That's the key. And they don't stay more than 90 days. Now, there is, when you're doing your HUD applications, you're going to have, I think it's the form, but they may change, but it had been 3B, where basically you talk about what your target populations are on that. A lot of the stuff you put in those applications are really important. They come back to you. And so if you do have target populations, and those target populations are important to your project, that's what your staff to serve, you really do want to indicate that, because it allows you to designate that you really have a priority to serve your target population, and basically can say, you really need to be sending us people who need, who again, if we're targeted towards the seriously mentally ill and you identify that as the target population, you can definitely have preferences in terms of the folks who are sent to you through coordinated entry, in terms of the folks that you're serving. You can identify that as a criteria for folks that you want to serve. And even, if God willing, you get to the state there aren't chronically homeless, it means that you can continue to serve that target population. Because it is important, because that's what your staff do, and qualified and experienced to serve. Yet at the same time, if there is nobody who's got your, target population, we're going to serve homeless people. And so under those circumstances, that if there's nobody who meets your additional target, then we're going to take the next homeless people who meet the definition. You don't want to make keep units vacant while we're waiting for that last crime victim homeless person. We want to make the best level of effort to find the appropriate person, but if we don't have them, we're going to take the person who's got the highest needs that's next, the next referral to us. And we know, especially with chronically homeless people, I mean, sometimes, you know, you can like offer them the housing, but you know, it can take a while from that offer to when people are really willing to accept it and really do all the things that well. And again, we want to keep engaging folks, getting them ready for housing, even if we're not immediately placing them into housing, because that's the process. That's the system to make it work. Okay, So this is interesting. We're getting into, and we're going to have more slides in it, but there are some additional provisions that have come in under the Violence Against Women Act that give additional protections and safeguards for folks. And remember, the violence against women is, I don't want to call it a misnomer, but really is violence against human beings. VAWA protects all victims of domestic violence, not just women, victims of domestic violence. And as we have seen in, I don't know what you call the sexual, the Me Too stuff, in our country, we see it cuts across the board, and you know, all kinds of people can be victimized. And so we want to offer protections to all people who are being victimized. And basically, you know, this is brand new, that there are circumstances to transfer folks, even transfer folks if they need it for their personal safety, outside of this jurisdiction of this continuum of care in order to provide their safety. And folks have to understand that there is that right, and there are, and I understand you folks have gotten training, but I'm gonna go through this a little later on, but there are some very important notifications that you've got to give to all adult participants in your program informing on these rights. This is another thing that HUD will monitor you for, and that's really important to remember, that you've got to give these VAWA forms to folks, and it's not just head of households, it's all adult members of the household. That's very important. It is recognized that sometimes, you know, you can have like a male head of the household who is the abuser, you know, and you can give him this information, like he ain't gonna share that with the person that he is abusing. That is why you want to independently make sure that all adult members of the household are familiar with these rights, because that may be how they get to exercise those rights. This year, in the past NOVA, there was a new provision. We always had the dedicated chronically homeless beds, and HUD had a lot of priority in dedicating permanent supportive housing beds to the chronically homeless. This year they created this new category of dedicated plus permanent supportive housing beds. It sounds a bit like a checking account that some sort of bank is going to issue. Oh, here's your dedicated plus account. So, to get dedicated plus, you have to be one of these things. And by the way, you know, if in your application to HUD, you either, and everybody, I believe, indicated that they were either chronic homeless dedicated or dedicated plus, all permanent supportive housing in the COC, I'm virtually certain, indicated that. So if that is the case, if you're dedicated, you can only serve chronically homeless. If you hit the dedicated plus thing on your prompt thing, these are the folks that you can serve, and these are the only folks that you can serve. Obviously, you can serve chronically homeless. They're not going to take that away. But you can also, and we knew that, you know, HUD is doing this campaign against transitional housing. So if it was a transitional housing program in the end, they probably already ended it, because it happened a couple years ago. So I don't know that we're going to have any people who are still coming from a transitional housing project that was eliminated. That's going to be the case in other COCs. What they found out, one of the things that really went wrong with the dedicated chronically homeless thing is that people, and it happens, people lose housing despite our best efforts. You know, some people are not going to be able to maintain that housing. What went wrong is that those people had been housed in permanent housing, so they lost their chronic homeless status. They went back to the shelter, and then they couldn't get rehoused because they didn't meet the chronic homeless definition anymore because they weren't housed. And so we said, you got to spend another year in the shelter. That's cruel. And HUD recognized that under dedicated plus. So therefore, somebody had been in permanent housing, lost that within the past 12 months, you can rehouse them under the dedicated plus component, which is a good thing. We know, and we have three projects last year funded under this new joint transitional housing rapid rehousing approach. There are three new projects in Indiana that have been doing that approach. So folks who are in that transitional housing component would remain eligible under the dedicated plus permanent supportive housing if they were chronically homeless when they entered that. that Joint Transitional Housing Rapid Rehousing Program. So, in case you had two occasions, episodes, spells of homelessness, over, and those two things total up to 365 days, under Dedicated Plus, you can serve them without having to come up with the four breaks on homelessness. Now remember, if you're a dedicated, chronically homeless project, you can't use this, you know, less than four episodes in 3 years. You've got to have the four episodes if you're dedicated, chronically homeless. If you're Dedicated Plus, you can have fewer than four episodes, but you must still have the 365 days. It's just, it's kind of an end run around that sort of crazy, that craziness that you gotta have the four different episodes in order to qualify. They have, in a lot of instances, they really opened the door, because we know that the VA has got a sort of parallel system of both transitional and permanent housing, and they really made it much easier on Dedicated Plus for folks to move from one system to another. So there could be folks who are getting grant per diem support, as which is the transitional housing program run by the VA, who might be eligible for moving, for transitioning into permanent housing through the COC side. They also have their SFES, Support Service for Veteran Families, that provide some level of rapid rehousing assistance. Some of those veterans might move into the, and HUD has made it possible for folks to move from the veterans system to the continuum care system more easily. So,
Howard, wait, I'm sorry, before you go, can you switch back? So for people that had been receiving assistance from VA homeless programs, so if they were receiving SSEF rapid rehousing, mm-hmm. and they were in that program for maybe 6 months, mm-hmm. and it didn't work out, they were not able to sustain the housing, that too could be used as a bridge for housing into a dedicated bus unit.
Yes, it could. Yep.
That's fantastic.
Yep. Now you want to, again, you're going to want to document their status prior to entry into that. The VA homelessness, but yes, they can move from SFEF into, and which is great, of course, because SFEF, of course, is not run directly, you know, some programs are run directly by the VA, and when programs are run directly by the VA, they do not necessarily participate in HMIS and stuff like that. SFEF contractors, of course, required to participate in HMIS, so you should have that HMIS record, which should help you on that documentation of eligibility. Again, the concept is, it's hoped that when people are placed in SFEF, that'll be sufficient to end their homelessness. But we want to end all homelessness, but especially want to end better homelessness. So folks, you know, maybe, you know, been placed there and they can't sustain it. And so this is an option for them to get it. They could eventually also transfer into HUD Bash as well, but the VA has got some strange policies about people going from SFEF to HUD Bash, and made it a little harder for that transition to occur. You're welcome. Okay, so as I said, if it is a dedicated, chronically homeless unit, you must, in the Pistons file, have that verification of disability, and I get what a bear that is, and I'm sorry about that. Have that verification of disability in their file, and on top of that, have verification in the file that they meet the chronic homeless debt, that they meet the time, amount of time homeless to meet the chronic homeless debt. Okay, so self-certification, thank you. I'm sorry, there's so many slides into the future to get there, but I knew it was going to come. So, needless to say, you can't ever, ever, ever self-certify a disability, so that is always going to require some outside verification to count. You can, all participants, you are, the regulations allow you to self-certify up to 3 of the 12 months of homelessness, so you can accept 3 months self-certification. For everybody, no more than 3. You can, for up to 25% of the folks that you serve, but be careful about self-certification, but for up to 25%, you can self-certify more than 3 months. So up to 25%, you could actually self-certify, but be careful. You only want to do that kind of self-certification thing when you really need to help that household, and you just can't get that documentation. It's always risky, but the regulations would allow that for up to 25%. But you know, if that comes in and they hit a file that's 100% self-certified, they're going to look at other files to make sure that they're not all 100% self-certified. So, and remember, when they do come in to monitor, they're going to randomly pull charts, and you have no idea who they're going to look at. So there is some risk. If you do the self-certification, it's all HUD always wants third-party stuff, whether it's income, whether it's
homelessness, whether it's anything like that. So if you do, you're also going to be expected that you made a good faith effort to find something other than a self-certification, at least of homeless status. So if you're doing that, again, 100% self-certified, you should have something in your file that shows that whoever was who did the intake work on that participant did make some efforts to get some third-party verification of what went on, and also some documentation as to why they were unsuccessful in getting any third-party verification. So they will ask for that. As I said before, breaks in homelessness can be entirely self-certified. So again, if you've got an HMIS record, if you've got a shelter record or something like that, that shows that they were homeless for 3 months, or you know, an outreach worker that says that we saw this person, hanging out on the arches near Union Station, that's okay for those 3 months, and then you can get your participant to self-certify a break, because you know you're gonna need those breaks since there as well to make your chronic homeless file. HUD does allow you to have in the file a self-certification and gives you up to 180 days, 6 months to come up with that documentation. Be careful, obviously. I mean, because there are two risks that could happen. One, somebody forgets to go back, you know, within 6 months and put the documentation in the file, and then HUD comes to monitor and oops. So be very, very, very careful about, you know, we want to get people off the streets. We want to get people in housing. Sometimes we will do some of the self-certification things to get that immediate goal, but don't ever forget to come in and backfill with the appropriate documentation.
Our largest emergency shelter does not enter any data into HMIS. Can we use as third-party documentation just a printout like of the enrollment page of HMIS to show the different services that they've been in, like if they were maybe a coordinated entry or had they been in a SSDF program, is any of that?
Would they give you, will they give you any, I mean,
no,
will, I mean,
no.
They will give you a letter saying that the
no.
person has been at my
oh,
shelter?
Oh, please, no. So I run my outreach worker today,
yeah.
And so there's only two of them. And
yeah.
So it's really, we need to do something different to get third-party verification. But we do coordinated entry, we do SSDF, we do permanent supported housing, we do rapid rehousing, so we have all of this data in
yeah.
HMIS. It would be really nice if I could just show the picture, like print off the page.
We can't get any observations of these folks being in shelter. Can the outreach worker say that, you know, they encounter them in the shelter?
Yes,
that's what you do. Yeah.
But I have more than just.
I think so. Yeah, but I mean, if you do that every month, I mean, it sort of becomes a third. I mean,
yeah.
You know, I mean, and again, it's just a monthly observation will count.
I have 700 clients right now.
Yeah.
So that's my thing.
Yeah.
I need more than just.
Yeah. So what we can get, so you're saying out of HMIS we can get, and that HMIS will show that person is accessing homeless services.
Yes.
And
can that be used as third party?
And the only way they could have accessed those services were if they were homeless.
That's correct.
Yeah, I think you can.
Okay. Good.
Yeah. Okay, so what counts as third party documentation? The HMIS record,
okay.
All these things do. Yes, a letter from a shelter or outreach worker is certainly going to count as third. Some of these things are, oh, what's going on? Okay. You know, but that also means, you know, you could have, I mean, again, if somebody's street homeless, you know, I mean, if they're, you know, hanging outside a store, you know, just any member of the community can say, I've seen this person hanging out there, you know, living there, you know, any member of the community can say that. There are, there are different standards for if it's a professional, if it's somebody you're staffing this observation as opposed to a community member, I'll tell you about that, this is what you need to do. But anyway, all of these things count. I think this is gonna, yeah, I knew. So again, clergy person, doctor, counselor, therapist, law enforcement, I mean, if the police have you know, if they have a home, sometimes their homeless outreach teams or police departments, if they are familiar with folks living, then documentation from them is completely fine. You can even, goodness gracious, okay. So basically, you know, community members, observer, and basically your intake worker uses professional judgment saying, yes, that makes perfect sense that what they're saying is this folks is homeless. And basically, if it is a housing service provider, you've got to base, and you're talking about people who are not living in shelter and stuff like that, you've got to provide some documentation as to where those folks were living unsheltered for that period of time. And again, you know, people can only verify, they can't say that they've seen it unless they actually observe folks at least one time during the course of that month. So let's talk about some possible scenarios, obviously, because we want to Sir, you issue one. So obviously, if a 20-year-old is living in a car, clearly that's somebody who is literally homeless. If you have, you know, even if people, this kind of scenario here of somebody who's living with somebody and basically gets to stay there because they are sharing their body, basically, that is considered to be, you know, a domestic violence abuse situation, and they would meet the definition under category four homelessness. As we said, you know, there can be systems, if certainly if they're a ward of the state, then they are basically the state's responsibility to care for them until they're 18 years of age and should not be considered to be literally homeless. So everybody, you're all, if you've got a HUD grant, you are, in addition to the COC having written standards and policies, every individual provider should have their own written policies and procedures for intake and for admitting people to the program. How do they kind of monitor is going to want to see what your written policies and procedures of your program, and it must indicate what kind of what procedures this your program is supposed to do to verify and document that people were homeless and disabled when they program. And as I said before, you know, there are a lot of provisions in these things where you can make a provisional determination, but you need to go back and re-verify with that information. So if there are you know, any times when you're relying on basically trying to get that third party stuff, you're required to show that document, that due diligence that you engaged in to get that third party verification. Again, what HUD comes in, the first thing that we look at is whether or not participants are eligible for the services that they receive. Like I said, if it's a dedicated chronically homeless bed, it's not enough that they are homeless. They've got to meet the chronic homeless definition, and obviously anybody in permanent supportive housing has got to be homeless and disabled, and that documentation is absolutely got to be there.
What if they have been in the project before that January 2016 and we don't have that 365 days because that wasn't a requirement before?
That's okay. As long as you want to document when it was that they were admitted into the program.
Right.
It doesn't, you don't have to, you certainly would not be required to exit them from the program because they changed the definition of them. As long as your paperwork documents that they were not admitted before that January of 2016 date, yeah. It's fine. After that January 2016 date, then they have to meet the new definition. Are we okay? Okay. So remember, increasingly, everyone's participation in coordinated entry is mandatory. Increasingly, admissions to programs are going to come from referral from coordinated entry. You will, you know, over the course of the next 12 months, you will see more of that in your operations. You have to, COCs have their own written standards and policies. In addition to the HUD regulations, you've got to follow the policies that are established by the continuum care. It's easier to impact the policies of the continuum care than it is to impact HUD regulations. So if there's some things that the policies of the continuum care that are not working for you, those can be changed pretty easily. But you've got to be consistent with the COC policies. You are required, every provider who's got this assistance is required to have your own written set of policies and procedures for your program. And you've got to follow that. And obviously, you know, we follow our prioritization. So, I'll go for it. The HUD, basically redefined the concept of family. Basically, what HUD has said is that a family is a group of people who present together and call themselves a family, regardless of marital status, regardless of gender, regardless of sexual orientation, regardless of anything. We respect people identified as a family, and we do not ask beyond that. We do not ask for documentation of that status. We do not separate folks. I mean, they used to happen a fair amount, but we do not, in all services, we do not separate families. Used to be not uncommon, I guess probably a lot of our unfunded, a lot of faith-based shelters would not serve families unless they came in with a marriage certificate, and would force the intact families to be divided in order to receive emergency shelter services. This is something that HUD feels is not really helpful. As helpful as it could be for folks, so we try not to divide up families under any circumstances and serve families as they come. If you have a used to be, it was very common, a lot of projects did women and children's projects, and I get that. But HUD has basically said, you know, if it's a family with children's project, you know, if it's a male-headed family without a woman present, you still have to serve that father and his kids the same way you would serve the mother and kids. There only are very, very, very limited grounds for basically making sure the project can only serve one gender, and that is only when you cannot provide basic privacy protections to folks. So if you've got a situation where this becomes, you know, any time you've got a fully self-contained apartment where people are going to have, you know, a bathroom and, you know, sleeping rooms that are at a door that separates that unit from everywhere else, it's going to be very, very difficult to do anything but serve all families under that setting. If it's more of an SRO single room occupancy situation where there's some shared bathroom facilities, still then, you know, and you can have, you know, people just have a single room, you can have more than one gender on that floor, which is not how people generally operated. As long as those bathrooms, you know, basically are intended to be used by a single person and can lock the door and have access to all those things, you can have, you know, more than one gender occupying that floor. So they're really, there are very, very limited circumstances under which, you know, you cannot, which basically cannot serve people based on their gender. Very, very, very limited circumstances. And there is some understanding here that there really are some issues. We know, especially women who have experienced homelessness, experienced sexual trauma at absurd, at horribly high rates. And we do not want to re-traumatize people in the guise of helping them, and we want to be sensitive to that trauma that people have experienced. So we really have to walk, I think, on the edge of a razor blade on this thing without necessarily re-traumatizing people who've had some really bad experiences, and at the same time without discriminating against people based on their gender. It's as simple as that. And HUD very much is waiting on the side, we're not going to discriminate based on gender. Go ahead.
Is this specifically speaking to a situation when a child is present, or is this any presentation?
It's basically any presentation. You know, I mean, anything, and it's really talking about gender-restricted housing. And, you know, there are very, 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 very limited circumstances in which, you know, the gender-restricted housing would be allowed. Also, needless to say, I mean, implicit in all that is, you know, when we're dealing with people who are transgender, we respect how they present themselves, and we do not pay attention to biological issues, and we don't pay attention to anything else. If somebody comes in and presents as a gender, we respect their decision there.
I assume that can happen post-program enrollment as well. So person number one was enrolled and now they present to somebody else and say, this is my family member.
So you're talking about somebody who's not originally in the household and they want to add that person to the household group. Yeah, okay, well, you know, now we're talking about a different set of circumstances when we're talking about adding people to the household as opposed to somebody, you know, meeting the homeless definition and everything like that. So if they are, as long as, you know, purpose for passing, as long as you remain having what they call the qualifying individual, you know, other people can be added to that household, and those other people do not necessarily have to qualify. Look, people, well, we hope, I mean, I think one of the signs in which people are stabilizing in the community is they actually form relationships, and those relationships may be, you know, because when you're homeless, it's really hard to form a relationship when you're living in a shelter, because those dates don't last very long. And people will, you know, sometimes they're going to be good for them, sometimes they're not going to be good for them, and, but people will make mistakes. People are allowed to.
But they have to be considered family to be added to the household, right? Or not?
But people can form a relationship. I mean, they could become, I mean, they could become, anybody can become married these days, so they, you know. And you can't require, again, you can't say that they have to have a marriage, that the only way you can allow somebody else to come in is if they are married. So, again, somebody can form a relationship, you know, and ask for you to increase their household to include that additional person. Generally speaking, I mean, there is some provided discretion as to whether you're going to allow that to occur. But remember, and something they have to realize is, if they add a member to the family, there are a couple of things. First of all, that person's income is going to count. Sometimes when you tell them that, their motivation to be added to the family diminishes a little there. But so if they're a family member, their income is going to count. You have to count their income. I think we have seen that, you know, if people can form stable relationships, that's really good for them. You know, and sometimes, you know, people in a relationship can function, you know, two people can function at a higher level sometimes than a single person. And all that can help towards stability. So it's not a bad thing. It's, again, but there is a difference between the qualifying member and other members of the household. So that would mean, you know, if it's a chronically homeless unit, and you had your, you know, chronically homeless woman that's occupying the unit, you know, and a partner comes along, male or female, don't matter. If that person, you know, is not chronically homeless when they enter that unit, if we, you know, our prime person, the woman who we were serving to begin with, if she leaves that unit, if she passes, if something happens, that other person who's there has got no occupancy, cannot remain in doubt. There's some limitations as to how long they can remain in that unit without the qualified individual being present at the same time. So if they don't, you can add people, but if it's a dedicated unit, restricted unit, and they don't meet that definition, if you lose the qualified person, you're going to lose eligibility for that unit.
Okay, I have a question. Our housing project, we're 27 one-bedroom units,
yep,
and intended for single people and couples,
yep,
but recently we have had a resident that wanted to move in, a childhood friend and her toddler. Now, in the permanent supportive housing manual, there's a distinction between the HUD subsidy standards and the housing quality standards as far as how many people for a one-bedroom,
yep,
apartment. So we didn't know how that would play out. He ended up changing his mind, but if he would have pursued that, would our hands have been tied as far as him moving in two more people into the one-bedroom unit with fair housing laws and familial status law?
Yeah, good question. So, you know, we do have these things, occupancy standards. The occupancy standards we get to, you know, and we, you know, in the Section 8 thing, it's always the same as two heartbeats to a room concept. I mean, the concept that HUD always has is you're overcrowded when you have more than two persons occupying any living, sleeping room. So again, if you had a one-bedroom unit, HUD would say that there are potentially two living, sleeping rooms in that unit. So potentially up to four people could live in a one-bedroom unit without necessarily making it an overcrowded unit. However, that might not be the best arrangement. HUD would say that what you could do is, you know, you could when you could safely house them there, but, you know, maybe but the toddler is going to stop, God willing, will stop being a toddler, and will have greater needs and greater privacy needs and things like that. So I would say you could transfer that, you know, if all you got are one bedrooms, they could transfer them to another permanent support housing program.
And that's what I was trying to encourage him to do, because, you know, with our housing project, you know, the disability criteria, we don't always look like a Christmas card, and so we're not really an ideal place for children to live.
Yep. So it becomes a kind of judgment thing. I mean, clearly they probably would want to help them locate another, and they could, you know, as long as they've qualified for that unit and there have been changes in their household that makes it important for them to have a different size unit, then that is allowable, and they could move from your program to another program and retain their status and be able to make that kind of a lateral transfer. Obviously, you then have a vacancy, and that vacancy would be filled by, you know, the next chronically homeless individual or family. It does happen, you know, but that does recognize people. Lives will change and their household compositions will change, and we've got to have some flexibility to address that. Are we okay? I'll go for another couple of minutes and I'll take her. As I said, this is all we're talking about is that, you know, in order to limit a project based on gender, you really have to come up with some personal privacy things and say we cannot really provide the level of personal privacy that folks really need to be able to survive. That's really the only grounds to limit a project based on gender. Again, lots of different tips. I mean, we just basically, you know, we respect our clients and we follow what it is their preferences and, you know, how they describe themselves, how we're going to describe themselves and how we're going to treat them, and we're not going to impose anything on folks whatsoever. And, you know, I mean, we really hope folks get some training and support and stuff like that, and get help their staff to get a full understanding as to how to effectively serve folks. And understand, especially on any domestic violence thing, there are sometimes, you know, as a result of domestic violence, the aggressor will do things that will really mess up the home, you know, or you know, disturb things. Whatever it is, in any kind of DV situation, we really got to differentiate the aggressor from the victim. And sometimes we do not punish the victim because they are been victimized. And because, you know, they could be a fight, they could be in the limb, they could want to evict everybody in the household because of this disturbance that's going on. We're not allowed to do that. We really want to protect the victim of that violence and not allow her to lose her unit because, you know, yes.
We've had a situation like that and been struggling with how to address that. Because the victim did not meet qualifying standards. It was the head of household was the abuser. And so we're in the midst of it actually right now, trying to figure out how to address the situation. How do we address the situation?
It is a problem, because we're talking about that like a dedicated crime and homeless unit where we have the aggressor met that chronic homeless definition.
Right, they're the head of household that meets the definition, and the partner is not.
So basically, what's going to, you know, what would happen in that situation there is, and we'll get to protection. Basically, what's supposed to happen is under VAWA, there's supposed to be this bifurcation thing. So we're supposed to be able to get the aggressor off of the lease and allow the lease to continue. The problem is, what would happen in this case, the best we could do, if you know, in this case it's a woman who's the victim there, the best we can do for her is to allow her to remain in the unit for the remainder of the lease term, and we can continue paying that subsidy for the remainder of that lease term. But unfortunately, you know, when that lease ends, we can't continue serving her because she is not eligible for that assistance. It, you know, it's funny, these things work differently in different programs, like the HUD-VASH program, which we all know is the VA Supportive Housing Program, which relies on a housing choice voucher as the subsidy number there. There, the rules are very different. The rule is there, even though, believe it or not, even though that program is earmarked for veterans, if the veteran is the abuser, and, you know, and her or his spouse is the victim, the veteran can be taken away from the unit, and the spouse, the partner, remaining partner, can continue holding that hot bash voucher. But this, that's not a bash thing. But you know, so different folks get higher rights under the continual care program. The right is they can remain in the unit until the end of the lease term. So if it's, you know, if it's month two of the lease, great, they get 10 months of additional assistance. If it's month 11 or 12, they get very, very limited additional assistance.
So since he's going through this right now, how would he document that for if HUD comes in and they're like, well, this isn't the head of the household anymore, this isn't the chronic person living in this apartment anymore, this is a dedicated apartment, like, how would you document that?
Well, I think, first of all, I mean, I think your case notes are going to have to show that there was some, you know, we've got some sort of domestic violence in your situation.
And the
police reports keep
right.
Copies of police
and the non-head of the household who's really running is going to stay there, like, how would he?
Yeah, now remember, too, when we talk about violence against women or any of the DV stuff, that is 100% self-certified. We don't re-victimize people by.
I'm just saying.
But if there are, if there were police reports,
I would put them in there.
But we also have the VAWA form. You know, okay. there is a form under VAWA which we'll get to where a victim can self-certify that they were the victim. Put that self-certification form in the file. Then we've got that documentation that this is what went on. It's a domestic violence situation, and we are doing the protection, and we're allowing them. We're continuing their subsidy until for the duration of the lease term.
Do we, the person who committed the act and we're removing them from the household, do we still have to provide them housing in a new unit?
No, you can send them back to, I mean, basically, I think what you do is come and send them back to coordinated entry. Because you don't have to. Basically, at that point, you've got coordinated entry. You know, you basically, they committed this thing, you exited them from the household. Basically, they'd have to go back. The only way they're going to get back into housing is going through coordinated entry.
But they lose their chronic homeless status, but they'd have maybe dedicated plus, we could get them in.
Maybe. Yep. And then it sort of, to some extent, becomes, you know, the coordinated entry policies and stuff like that as to, you know, what they will do to rehouse in those circumstances.
But is there a possibility coordinated entry will just spin them right back to you?
Not in our system. way down the list, probably.
In some systems, though, that's the only game in town.
I think that I'm going to have to look, you know, as we get, you know, our coordinated and policies, you know, more refined and working better. No, I think you would, certainly if it's a single site thing, you wouldn't send that abuser back to the same building. I mean, that just not provide the safety protections that people need.
Yeah. Okay.
I think this is a great time to take a break. So we're going to take, again, my goal would be to, you know, get us out on time or earlier. So we're going to try to keep it 10 minutes because lunch is going to be coming up fairly soon. And we will break. When you come back, we'll break again when lunch gets here because I know. For this, because if we all had to go away to get our lunch, it would take us 2 hours to get everybody back in the room. So it is great. So again, you know, we want to make sure this equal access stuff is important. There are new rules, there are new procedures about it. Your staff should be trained about it and recognize that at least as things currently stand, HUD celebrates diversity, understands that there are different kinds of households, and we respect people. And we do believe that a lot of times, if people are able to make those connections with other people, if they can help them really maintain housing and be stable. We don't, as most, I mean, some people work perfectly fine living alone for their entire lives. Most of us don't. We work better when we've got a partner, we've got some other members of their household, either kids or puppies in my case. But it all helps us be able to stay together. So, okay. And here is, again, and we will send you these slides so you can have access to all these links and stuff like that. But our HUD has got a fairly, you know, good set of resources to help on the equal access and stuff like that. And here will be links to getting those resources. And they're also, you know, it's not, our participants should know that we follow these policies and stuff like that. So there is a thing that you can post on site here that you can have, and certainly if it's a single site building and things like that, that folks can see that we do have a policy that respects people's gender identity. Well, there's another thing that came up, and this also came up about a year and a half ago or so. The General Counsel's Office at HUD recognized that the way the criminal justice system works in this country, it has a disproportionate impact on members of minority groups. And therefore, to have blanket policies that say we're not going to accept anybody with a felony conviction, to just across the board say any encounter with the criminal justice system is grounds in and of itself for us not to accept you into our program, as HUD says, is a violation of fair housing. And what they're saying is you really need to do a case-by-case determination of folks. You're not supposed to have blanket policies. And clearly, there are some exceptions to that. People who are on a level 3 sex offender registry and stuff like that, that is a different set of circumstances. Currently, what HUD would say is that you don't necessarily want to pay attention to arrests. You want to pay attention to things that people are actually convicted of. And on top of that, you want to make sure that prior to screening out somebody because of their conviction, you want to do an assessment, and that assessment indicates that person accepting that individual or that household into your project is going to create a risk for the other people that you're trying to serve, and that's the reason why you're not accepting it. But it's really got to be on that individualized determination. You cannot simply just say, no, I'm not going to admit anybody who's got a conviction for any felony whatsoever. We've got to look into when that occurred, whether there are extenuating circumstances, whether there is reason to believe that individual might not pose a risk. If they do have a violent felony history and you believe that they still remain a violent individual, that's grounds, because of that individual determination not to admit them to the program. It's not grounds just because, without doing any further exploration as to see whether or not that really does pose a risk to your project or your residence. This is important, and we gave people a buy on this last year, but participation by homeless people is a requirement. It's in the regulations. We said last year for project applicants that this was a threshold factor, that if you do not have homeless representation on your board of directors, you would not be allowed to apply for a renewal of your grant. We said that as a threshold factor. I think we were a little lenient last year. Do not count on continued leniency. This is important. This is a HUD requirement. HUD will monitor on you. You must have a homeless or a formerly homeless person on your decision-making body. If you cannot do that, you should be going to HUD seeking a waiver from this requirement and telling HUD what your alternative process is to have homeless representation. HUD will in certain circumstances. A lot of times the grantee is going to be an entity like IACEA. That is a problem.
for a governmental agency to have a homeless representative, and there can be ways around that. But unless you've got a situation like that, if you're a nonprofit organization, then I would see there's not necessarily any reason why you could not have a consumer or a homeless or a formerly homeless person on your board.
This is a question, I guess. That would never happen with the company that I work for. How would we even, how would we even go forward with something like that? Recommending that, they look at us like we're crazy people.
Please.
Some of you, probably most of you know that recently I circled around with some of you to just verify that you do have some form of homelessness representation. This is a critical matter for IHCDA and for our COC as a whole, because as Howard said, we probably were a little too kind last year in this threshold item, but we won't be able to be so again, because as some of you know, IHCDA was monitored by HUD, and as part of our continuing resolution to the findings, we had to verify that all of you that are subrecipients under IHCDA actually have some sort of lived experience either on your board or on something that HUD allowed. So to answer your question, Sarah, specifically, if you don't have that, then we need to work with HUD for a plan. And I will say it is very complicated. We would love to have gotten a waiver as IHCDA, but that was not an option even for us. So we really need you all. I know there are a couple of people that still are struggling with this. We will work with you, but we don't have a long time either to get this resolved, because we'll talk a little bit about that later today.
Please work with us, because I have no idea how to even start that conversation with the company that I work with.
Good. It's good we're having this dialogue.
Yeah.
So when Rachel Eichel was out a couple of years ago with us, they still need to do a housing council. And then have a member of the housing council report to the board. Member of the board, but just to report what the council
right.
That's what we're doing.
Right.
I think that's okay.
It is okay. However, I would say that it needs to be in your policies, or it needs to be something that we can document with HUD. I think the world of Rachel, but we have a different rep and he's a little tighter.
But this could be different. This was a couple years
ago.
Yeah, it sounds allowable, but what we found is that we have to have the documentation to show.
So
the policy
agency policy that we board, board policy to have.
Yeah.
We should have something in there that says
you've got to formally constitute that panel, whatever it is, and establish this is our consumer advisory panel, whatever you're going to call it. You've got to have in your written things in your agency that we recognize that we have this panel, this body that is this advisory thing. Your board of directors, you're going to want to have on the meeting minutes, maybe not at every meeting, but periodically they're getting a report back from that council, whatever you're calling it, and it's going to be on their agenda, and we can see both on the agenda the minutes that they heard that feedback from those participants. It really is, you need a paper trail around this, you really do, and it's not something, it's a real monitoring concern by HUD, and it's not something you can say, you can brush it aside. So if you're doing anything other than having somebody who is either currently or run any time in their lifetime, that HUD's homeless definition on the actual board of directors. That's the best thing to do. If there are institutional reasons why you can't do it, that you've got to set up a very, very, very formal long-term position. That's got to really clearly identify who that panel is, how you become a member of that. It's got to have some sort of rules associated with it. And organize and meet regularly, and your governing body has got to show, the record of your governing body has got to show that there has been that input. So, in addition to your environment, it's useful. We can get good feedback that way, and we want to. We want to learn from the folks that we serve, so it's not a crazy requirement on HUD's part. Are there more questions about this homeless participation thing? Because I think, even if HUD doesn't do the monitoring, just be prepared that when you're applying this year, for the renewal thing, that if you don't have a representative on your board, expect to provide to the COC that information on how you're otherwise meeting this requirement, or again, nobody wants to do it. We don't, because HUD so many
sets these things up so that people get punished if things don't right, or the homeless people we're trying to serve. So we want to enforce this in a way that's going to punish the people that we want to help. That is for sure. But at the same time, you know, it doesn't help any of them. If we're out of compliance with HUD, it doesn't help anyone. We've got to control it. Okay. Okay, a little review stuff. Can a group of friends from a shelter live together as a family in a continuum care project? Can a group of people who are not related live together as a family?
Yeah.
Yeah. If they present as a family, you know, I love that definition. I mean, I'm enough a nerd to, like, every now and then some, you know, some regulatory stuff that really respects people, just, it fills my heart. No, goodness gracious, this thing doesn't like it. We're going to go back. Okay, but it's allowed for a project to only accept men and women. You're going to see it, so you know, attention, but you get it. You know, you can only restrict to a gender when you have got real personal privacy concerns, not just because of a perceived potential risk. And you know, if it's a project for families and all and the kids have like grown up and left, you can't terminate the remaining adults because there aren't kids there anyway. The same thing as we heard before, you know, people's family composition will change. We may need to, you know, look at our written standards and stuff like that to make sure that we are recognized and give you good grounds as to what it is you can add or not add people to the household. But it's important because, you know, people grow, mature, and change, and we've got to be able to respect some of those life changes when we're certain. Okay, requirements. All right. So here comes some of our Violence Against Women Act. And as I said, this, again, it's violence against human beings. You know, anybody can be a victim of domestic violence or abuse. So basically, you cannot punish anybody for being a victim of domestic abuse. That's the takeaway. And on top of that, you've got to make steps to protect victims by either providing them alternative housing or by getting rid of the abuser and allowing the people who are not people or the victims to remain in the unit. And again, as this thing is saying, if you have a participant who like partnered up with this person, he or she is not supposed to even be on, not on the lease, that behavior of that other person cannot be the grounds for denying assistance or terminating the person who was legitimately occupying the unit. So as I said before, and we got, there is a BAWA form, but everybody, and this is something that was supposed to have been in place by December 2017, which is now in the past. So in all cases, and you may have to go back, but basically, certainly when you recertify folks, and you wouldn't necessarily have to do this before recertification, but you know, on an annual recertification or anybody in your program, if they're an adult member of the household and they have not received one of these BAWA rights forms, you've got to make sure that they receive that form when they recertify into the program. And HUD is going to be looking for these VAWA forms.
Is that for all participants or only if they were housed because of the VAWA?
No, all, because it could happen to anybody. All adult, and it's all adults, again, not just the head of household. Anybody who's above the age of 18 who's in that household has got to get that form.
Besides an intake, did you just say that every recertification?
Well, no, only if you didn't, it's at intake. But you know, it's a new requirement, so it's possible that you have people in the system who do not have these forms on file. I'm saying at the minimum, when you recertify them at this point, you want to bring this paperwork up to speed.
Can you go back a slide? I'm wondering about VAWA rules for non-HUD COC funded landlords. So we've got a lot of private landlords that perhaps don't know this rule. This rule would pertain to them as well, that
sure,
they are not able to terminate someone because of violence in the home?
That's right. Yep.
And when they are doing that, then as how, you know, we're seeing people who are experiencing homelessness because of this.
Yeah.
So we can go back to the landlord and explain the rule to them.
Yep. Because that's a federal law, violence against women.
Federal law. And it's for any housing.
It becomes a fair housing concern, and fair housing applies across the board to housing.
Okay.
Yeah, but we hope.
I think we need to do some education.
Of course. Yep. And you know, I mean, I don't think it's a bad thing. I think, you know, they're seeing the situation of violence in my unit.
Yeah.
And I don't
know.
Oh, exactly. Without understanding, you know, the subtlety or the nuance of domestic abuse. now there is, we're going to, and I don't know that we have, but one of the things we're going to have in our written standards and policies is this emergency transfer thing, because basically it means that somebody, you know, can basically leave the state of Indiana, so we'd have to be able, you know, have a way to be able to transfer them to another place in the city system. You know, this is not some, this is policies that we need on paper, and again, you know, God forbid, if somebody really needs that protection, we want to offer it to them. Clearly, it's not something that we're going to be seeing every day, I hope. So this gets back to the question that we had before, the second bullet here. So if the evicted abuser was the person who qualified the family for COC assistance, basically, you know, we can only serve, if that's the qualifying individual, we can only continue to serve until the expiration of his term, as we explained before. And again, this is the real concept, that protection concept. This is what's going to apply to that with this bifurcation concept. We've got to understand that, you know, we basically go in and change the lease to remove the abuser and allow the remaining folks to remain in our lease. Oh, go back, stop it. So here's the thing. Certainly when it comes to incident certification, we get this, I said this before, we don't require people who have been victimized to get re-victimized by the thing. So we will, the only time, and we can accept self-certification in all instances in cases of domestic abuse or violence, the only time when we would question is self-certification if we have some evidence that contraindicates what it is that they're self-certifying. You know, but if we do not have any evidence that does God go against the claim of domestic violence, then we're going to respect the victim's claim that it was a case of domestic violence. Obviously, you know, clearly if there are police reports, if there are other things like that, we can certainly accept that as documentation. No one's saying, oh, that's not allowable documentation. We're saying, don't require you have to go back to the police or do anything like that, especially if that can have a traumatic impact on folks. So these are, and again, we'll send you these slides so you can get this link. But basically, it's this form, this HUD form 5380, which is what you've got to provide to all these people. HUD has actually interpreted this into 14 languages in addition to English. So it's pretty extensive, the coverage of this thing. Interestingly, you know, I also am fortunate to do a fair amount of work in Nebraska. And yet, basically, the first language we got in Nebraska they translated to was Arabic. We've got, they have in Lincoln is amazingly, Lincoln, Nebraska is an amazingly diverse city. There are a lot of refugees that come into our area. So some of this interpretation is a useful thing.
Mm-hmm. Just yesterday, I actually took the webinar that's an hour long that I think really started in November. So I'm a little behind. As I told you in my email, they know my forms. I have all these now. But I think that's something that if there's other people, I see people writing notes, so I wasn't the only one that didn't know about these forms, that it would be very helpful to send out, because I emailed the gal, whoever it was at the Indiana Domestic Coalition, to get the webinar. I need to show my staff. Like, it's good for me to know, but I've got people that are actually New York service. That 1 hour webinar was very helpful.
Yeah, just we do have, we can give you the link to that training. It's something that we worked with ICAPD on, I think she did the training in November. So if you don't know what in the world we're even talking about with these forms, we're happy to give you the link. And as Howard said, it does need to be incorporated into some of the paperwork that you have, either at research or, you know, when new individuals are bringing into your unit. So it's a federal requirement. We're not necessarily the experts. That's why we had ICAPD get involved and help us on the training side of that. But if you need the link, let me know, and I'll make sure to get that to you.
Okay. Oh, and so this, wait a minute. The occupancy rights, that's the thing that everybody receives and signs. The transfer plan is something that you would have in effect in case we need to move somebody outside of the jurisdiction of what you're doing. The certification, that's the form that folks, that's all they need to complete to basically establish that they are a victim of domestic violence is through them using that HUD form. And there's this form to ask for that emergency transfer request.
education rights is another really important thing. It's something else that we check off in our forms. You know, basically, as part of the application process, you have to say, is there somebody in your organization that's responsible for creating that liaison to your local educational authority? It's so important to make sure that the kids are immediately connected to school. I mean, what we want to do, of course, is stop homelessness from being an intergenerational issue, and the way to make that happen is to give the kids the education and resources to be able to sustain themselves. So to really do our job, we've got to make sure, basically, you've got to make sure that you've got everyone who's a recipient there has got to have a staff person who has got the assigned responsibility to make sure that they have connections with the homeless liaison and the local education authority they've been working with. So somebody on their staff has got, and it's really got to be formally designated, it is their responsibility to maintain that liaison. But obviously, we know the comfort thing. We need to enroll kids in school as quickly as possible. We want to respect schools of origin whenever we can, because we know it's much easier for kids to maintain their academic standards and force them to leave school after school after school.
And it's also for young adults, 18 to 24?
Yes, that's right. So it goes all the way up to age 24. So even if, same thing on those farms, if you're serving, even if your program is only adults, but if you say your target population include consultants defined youths up to age 25, so as long as you're serving people under 25, you would still have to have this designated staff person to act as the liaison.
I go to the meeting for the Fort Wayne, Indiana area public community schools. Do I have to be involved with these homeless committees for every school system we're servicing in our service area?
The liaisons. They what? Should have, each school should have or district should have a homeless liaison.
You
know, they are called that because that's what the child is connected to. Well, I mean, that's... Okay. You are required. The regulations require, and they're going to expect to see this in the file, that at least on an annual basis, you have done an assessment of these things, their support services needs, the availability of those services, and you know the extent to which they are coordinated. So there should be at every one of your files, there should be something that shows on an annual basis that whoever is the case manager has done some sort of an assessment of their service needs. The regulations require that. Now, needless to say, when we're talking about permanent supportive housing for chronically homeless folks, and in their initial months of occupancy, I don't think that an annual assessment of their service needs is anywhere near adequate. I mean, this is something you want to assess much more regularly when folks go into housing. But HUD rules are that you must, at a minimum, have an annual assessment of their service needs, and you need to show that you have the case manager, at least on an annual basis, has assessed their service needs and that we are responding to those needs. Is that clear? Because I'm seeing some folks.
What is this supposed to look like? We do a self-sufficiency matrix every year,
okay.
Every cert, and things like that. Is that
okay? Yep. As long as you got something formal in the file that shows that you've been, checked out what their needs might be, and you try to assess it, and hopefully seeing, some folks' positive progress. Anytime you got, anything putting in the municipal files, you should always have a date and a signature associated with it to root it into a time and place for HUD. So just as a good chart work, try to have all of those things signed and dated by who's ever putting them in the file. Another thing. So a lot of you folks, if your grant includes funding for supportive services as well as rental assistance or leasing, any of the housing costs that are associated with it, and you're using the grant to pay for the costs of supportive services staff associated with it, there are a couple of things that you want to show. Obviously, we know that HUD expects there to be timesheets, so that if somebody is paid under this grant, we've got some documentation that they were actually in the office doing that work on a regular basis, and we're billing HUD for that. So we do want anybody who's paid for under these continuum care grant funds, there should be some kind of a timesheet associated with it. Depending on how the time is broken out, if they're only working on supportive services for a single HUD grant,
then basically all you need is a timesheet showing that they, the first thing is just a timesheet signed by the worker and the supervisor that they were in place because they're paying for entirely out of one budget line. If, however, they're working on more than one grant or working on more than one budget line, then they're also going to have a timesheet that's going to have to break out their time according to what grant they were working on and which component of the grant they were working on if they're funded under more than one line. In addition to that, timesheets, that's always been a requirement. In addition to that, HUD, if you've got somebody who's saying, I spent 8 hours on today, January the 18th, providing case management, then HUD would say, well, okay, can you show me some participant file that has some case notes associated with it that show you actually did some case management on the 18th of January? So in addition to the timesheet, there should be some sort of a case notes, some sort of documentation that something happened on behalf of folks. So in addition to having timesheets, remember, we should be seeing, the charts should show activity. There should be progress notes. There should be, anytime they're having contact with that individual, it should be noted in the chart, it should be dated, so we know that the case manager is doing that. So HUD will be looking at that.
So what happens if your housing program has an MOU with the community?
Okay. Then we want to have, you know, this sort of double record. We want to have both the timesheet that we know the physical body was there, and we want case notes to show that that physical body actually was doing something on behalf of those clients. If you're talking about, if the support services are coming by a third party, now are you using those as part of your match? Okay, great. If you're allowed to, I'm going to get into match more in the afternoon. But, you know, we know that most of the funds, match is hugely important. Hugely important HUD. Let me tell you, if you cannot document your match and HUD comes to monitor you, there is no question HUD is going to say, you send us a check to the federal government for every dollar of match that you haven't documented. I guarantee they are going to say that to you if you cannot document your match to them. So it's hugely important. If you are allowed, the match can either be cash or in kind. I'll talk about this some more. But we're talking about basically an in kind match where the mental health agency is providing services to your participants. If that is the case, first off, you know you need to have that MOU executed prior to the start of the grant year. But that's not enough. You then, at the conclusion of the grant year, you've got to document that those services were actually received by your participants. So the only way, if you're meeting your match, not by cash, but by in-kind, by services, by some outside participant, you're going to have to complete the circle. And at the end of the year, you're going to have some documentation that your clients actually received the services that are counted. Again, they should have case records in their agency that they had however many mental health, I mean, especially if they're billing Medicaid or
they're not going to turn those over.
They're protected on HIPAA. We don't want the case notes. We just want to know that they had, you know, again, if they're
billing
the invoice. Yeah, you know, so we're billing, you know, 1 hour of, again, we don't want that diagnosis information. We just want to know some documentation that this person received services. And the in-kind matches is the documentation requirements on it are far more extensive than a cash match, but you know, sometimes in the way you need the match.
Yep.
And there's the parent that we'll talk a little more about Housing First, but again, you know, we are following Housing First, and so again, you know, your case notes should be consistent with that. So your case notes are showing that, you know, we're sanctioning this person for doing things that are not consistent with Housing First, that should be an issue. Oh, and here, let's talk about Housing First for a couple of minutes here. We know Housing First operates on multiple levels. It certainly operates on entry to the project. The concept on Housing First on project entry is low barrier. I mean, basically, there are very, very few grounds for not admitting a participant in the program, and those grounds really have to do with, you know, potential risk to other participants in the program. They become among the only reasons why we're going to deny housing. Obviously, we're not going to deny housing because of credit history. We're not going to deny housing across the board because of criminal background. We're not going to deny housing because people are using substances.
we're not, basically, there are very, very, very few reasons to not offer housing to folks. Addition, you know, we are saying that once folks are housed, what we do is we measure them by their compliance with the terms of the lease. If folks are able to pay their rent at the start of a month, if they don't have unauthorized people in the unit, if they're not partying and disturbing their neighbors, if they maintain the unit with sort of basic sanitary things so they're not causing a health hazard for themselves or other people who are living in the building, then it don't matter what else they're doing. You know, I mean, if they are, you know, again, you know, if they're breaking the law, doing other stuff in the breaking the law, that is the problem. But, you know, if they are quietly in their unit, you know, doing a 12-pack each night, I mean, it's not the best thing for the health things, and there could be other things down the line, but if they're meeting their other responsibilities, then they're meeting their other responsibilities. And that, and we're only going to focus on their issue when it becomes an issue that they can't comply with their lease.
I feel like those were kind of the good old days when people just sat in their apartments and drank or moved in. But I don't know about some of you, but we have tenants that, and we are all about housing first, but it takes a minute or 12 months in order to really break down some of those supportive types of behaviors in order to get to the heart of the person. But if during that time, when they're still living in our housing units, they're terrible, like their behavior is terrible. Are there resources, has anybody in this room, I mean, I have staff that deal with this every single day about the behaviors of the tenants. Are there other resources to help staff other than motivational interviewing and all, I mean, they've done all that, but this is really, how do you talk to someone and get them to knock it off in order to stay in their house? Does anybody have any guidance on that? Because then, I mean, honestly, we're gonna start creating, if we went by what you just said, that we stick it to them with the lease, like if they're violating the lease, we would be a revolving door of tenants in and out of our PSH units. I need help with that.
It's like a huge thing.
So it's not just, we don't just have the old drums, just in
no,
units.
No, it's every day.
We use
the leases like leverage and stuff, but also we have like team meetings with them and stuff like that, and we work really closely with the landlord for a single site.
Thank God, I'm a landlord.
We do like everything.
I'm everything.
But
that's
we.
Why I drink at my house. Positive feedback. We paid for two CAH trainings. We did the module, the it's not transforming across the board. And I think with Housing First and permanent supportive housing and mental health, the mental health side, it should be intertwined. We need to be talking together, creating real solutions, because we can't have one without the other. And that's research documents that. And I think we're at a real, in Indiana, there's a real barrier there between what community mental health centers will provide and what, as a housing provider, we have. And I know Jill does this, so I'm not speaking to the provider with her, but.
Yeah, I think it's though, as a system, we need to figure out some solutions.
So I'd like to see for development day, the next time we have development day, this would be a great topic for direct service staff to all sit in the same room just like this and break talk about it.
Yeah, well, what would really be helpful is to get some of the people that are influencing the mental health system as a whole at this at funding level and maybe at other levels to really be engaged with us to begin the dialogue of how to change this, because this is a big deal.
And you really have a lobbyist group.
Yeah.
You know, and I think we really need to have a voice with them.
Yeah.
Because they're the people that make the change in the community of housing. And if we really want to make change, we've got to, you know, we've been talking to the community mental health centers and we're not going anywhere. We have for years.
Bring your vouchers and your PSH to Elkhart County. We'll help with it.
Okay.
I mean, we're housing some of their illest people. And so they need to support us and they need to provide support to their, I mean, it's ethically the thing to do for them. You know, it may not be their bottom line, but ethically, that's what it should be doing.
Yeah, I do know one of the things that's somewhat in the pipeline is that Medicaid waiver for housing. It's not moving very quickly, we probably, you know, we can talk at a later time about the lobbying part, because it's really not something that we can be engaged in per se, but you all can.
Right.
So let's talk about that.
I hear what you're saying.
It I is, think everybody in the room here.
Yeah.
No, I
mean, it is
it's
probably
hard.
Extremely complex.
It's hard. They're hard. Cases. But they're people that need housing.
And, you know, they're probably among the hardest cases. And, you know, and really, unfortunately, you know, HUD just puts all these requirements, does not sort of put the funding in place to allow you to do, because you do need resources to address the needs of these folks. There's no question about it. It doesn't just happen. And it is intensive, and unless you can provide that intensive support in the initial period of occupancy, then you set up this whole behavioral structure that you never get a chance to fix. And it really needs to be very intense. I mean, any example of this is say the services have been hugely intense on folks in the first group of housing. And the case manager should be in that unit at least once a week, if not more often. I mean, sometimes they have to be almost daily to help people do that transition, and that takes a lot of resources. And again, if you're relying on third parties, it's not going to happen. So I do get that. At the same time, what I like about it is the same, you know, is the high expectation. We do expect people to be able to follow these things. We try to hold them to that set of expectation standards that other people are being held to in the community, because then when they leave our services, they will have the skills that they need to be able to live elsewhere in the community. That's ideally the goal that we're trying to work towards here. But, you know, and I think this is, sometimes people feel that, you know, because it's Housing First, they are powerless. There is absolutely nothing that you can do. And that, you know, I mean, you know, basically you give them the unit, and the people's unit do what they please. This, in addition to being, you know, many thousands of dollars worth of cigarette product there, is clearly, you know, I mean, if one goes into a unit like this and sees clearly a risk to life and safety there, Housing First does not say, oh, well, it's Housing First, they get to do what they want. That is where you actually want to intervene and say, no, this is, you know, there is an unacceptable risk here, and this can't go on this way. This needs to be changed because it is an unacceptable risk. There are, you know, there are boundaries that are allowable on Housing First, and the boundary really has to do with, you know, what is going to present a danger to the health and safety of everybody there.
But our approach to some degree would be different than maybe a standard leaseholder in that our approach would be, how do we get them into compliance as opposed to how do we get them out of the apartment?
Exactly. Yep.
And only use that termination, you know, when there was absolutely no other alternative, because you're saying they're going to be re-referred anyway, so what are we getting? Okay, let's give something tonight. So remember, since this is timely, you know, you are allowed to terminate assistance to folks when it is appropriate to do so. But you can't terminate assistance without providing people with due process. So if it becomes necessary to terminate, remember, first off, on entry, to make it easier to terminate in the future, when people enter your program, they should know what their rules are and what they need to comply with, and they should basically present that in writing, and they should sign that, and it should be on their file upon entry, showing that they've been instructed and given a copy of what the program rules are. Now remember, it's Housing First. We don't really have a lot of program rules. We don't have house rules. We don't have things like that. Don't use this as the opportunity to create a lot of additional rules. The rules are trying to follow the terms of your lease. Even so, I mean, it's HUD is a little weird about this, but the same thing, you know, people are not required to meet with their case manager. You know, people can deny, you know, can refuse to participate in that level of services. If they are going to lose their unit, however, you can reach an agreement with the folks that, okay, in order for you to stay in this unit, you're going to agree to do these things, because basically giving you that opportunity to not do it, it hasn't worked. You're at risk of losing your subsidy. You know, Housing First is not the definition of insanity. It doesn't say that, you know, you have to keep doing the same thing over and over again and expect something different to happen. Housing First does not say you have to do that. So if somebody, you've given them the initial opportunity, they haven't done it. Then you can say, okay, we'll rehouse you, but we're going to do something different has to happen before we're going to rehouse you. Sometimes, you know, it's a fiduciary, a conservator, or a representative payee or something like that. Sometimes you can mandate, okay, we want there to be a direct debit from if you get a Social Security check and it goes into your checking account. We want, as soon as that check goes into your checking account, you agree that, you know, it's going to be direct debit out of that account going to your landlord to pay for your rent, something like that. That's all. Again, you wouldn't say we're going to pose those additional requirements when people first go into the unit, but you could certainly say when it has not worked, in order to continue housing you, we're doing this not because you're different, it's because, you know, it has not worked and we want to keep you in housing and we need to do something different in order to keep you in housing. That is completely legitimate under Housing First. And I will tell you, in theory, the Housing First approach came out of New York City, came out of Sam Barris's Pathways to Housing. I'm telling you, everybody that was initially in that program had to have a representative payee to even join the Housing First program when they started out that Housing First thing. So you can't say that representative payee requirements are not, have no consistency requirements with Housing First. Again, I don't think saying that it's a blanket rule across the board is consistent with it. Well, however, you know, we give people the opportunity. If it doesn't work, then we're not going to stop helping them, but we will make some changes in order for them to keep that going. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And how much are we allowed to step into that? I know in the lease it also says that they have to meet with the case manager at least monthly.
The lease
in the terms, yeah.
That shouldn't be a residential lease.
It's a
line.
It's a manager. It says they have to meet with a case manager at least monthly in the section that says,
it's in the rental assistance program agreement.
Yes, in the agreement part and everything. And I don't know, like, sometimes we have a hard time with, like, enforcing anything like that. I don't know how far we can step in or.
Is it supported housing?
No, it's actually in a lease. I'm not making this up, guys.
I'm sure you're not. That might be something to look at, though. Okay. So would that really mean a clause like that really needs to be in the lease?
And then, like, how much can services step in then? You're in your lease and everything, and yeah, you are paying your rent. Most of the time, it's on time and everything. We work with you on that. But this continues to be a problem, like you drinking and, you know, in the lobby and, you know, that kind of thing. Like, how much can we, like, step in then and be like, hey, something needs to change? Like, what is our leverage there? Are we allowed to, like, you know, if you're, obviously if you're making money, you're out.
Yep.
That's gonna be
But you know what you're talking, I mean, that's not unusual, again, in a standard residential apartment building situation for them to say, oh, by the way, in addition to this thing, there are, you know, you can't be, you know, breaking in the law, you know, they are allowed to restrict what it is you can do in public spaces of the building. That again, is consistent with any kind, and any apartment building is going to have limitations as to what you can do in the public areas, and there can be rules associated with that, and that is okay. And on top of that, no, I mean, again, the goal is to be modeling for folks what it is they need to do to survive the community. And if they're engaging these behaviors that are not going to be acceptable in other domains than your world, the goal is to wean them off of that behavior and basically establish some rules and requirements. Again, you know, we're going to try to avoid terminating folks, you know, for things where it's not, you know, sort of what you're doing. I mean, we kind of, you know, you're going to have to accept some behaviors that are far from ideal, because we don't want to return the people to homelessness. But at the same time, it's that delicate balance, like these other things. It's like, we're not going to turn around, but at the same time, this behavior is not acceptable. This behavior has to change. And we can assess, again, but it's not, when we can directly relate it to, you're going to lose your house. That's when the behavior becomes, you know, such. Go ahead.
So we run a rapid rehousing program,
yep.
And what we've run into is, you know, our portion of their rent is obviously getting paid on time, but
yep.
They're not paying.
Yep.
You know, we've done the conversation with the landlord, we've done the meetings with the tenant. Where is our obligation? If ours is a portion of the rent and we're covering it, and the landlord says, I cannot keep them here because they are 3 months behind on their portion,
yep.
What is our recourse? Do we have to step up and say, well, we're going to pay the 100%?
Okay. I mean, no. I mean, basically, then, you know, if they're not paying their share, they're not meeting their lease obligations, and the landlord has a right to. I mean, what? If anything, you're kind of lucky, because a lot of the times the tenant share is such that they don't go after it, because it's not. They're getting the bulk of the money from you regularly, and they say it's not worth it. That's not really a helpful landlord at all.
Well, and we've got really good landlords we've worked with. We've just found that, you know, somebody comes in and it's been hard. We've had a handful of people recently that just don't pay their portion because they know our portion's coming, and you know, and the landlord's getting frustrated with us because we put people with them that are not complying with their lease. So I know that we can't require them to participate in case management, for example. But if they can't participate in case management or they don't, and I'm still paying their rent,
yeah, but it's just when you can
for rapid rehousing. Well, and we've got it in our program agreement, and we have done the termination thing and all that. It's just, I don't know. We can talk later. I'll ask questions later.
No, that's
yeah.
Good. Those are good.
No, they are a good question. And you're right, you know, HUD is weird about this thing about, I mean, you caught one of their little contradictions there. Yes, they say we're all housing first and you can't mandate certain services. And then they say in rapid rehousing they must see the case manager at least monthly. It's like, okay. And this is consistent how. So sometimes they're guilty of what appear to be some inconsistencies.
One thing that we've tried in our program and we've had some success with residents that didn't pay their rent on time is, you know, well, for one thing, you know, if it's in the lease that, you know, if it's not paid at the 10th day of the month, it's late after that, we give them grace the first time and then we implement late fees. So we make them accountable, but I found that when somebody realizes that their housing's in jeopardy because of it, they're more apt to consider getting auto bill deduct from their checking account or wherever their like monthly benefits check is deposited. And then it just comes out automatically the first of the month. Now that's something that they would agree to do, but it's been successful with us. And then it just automatically comes out of their check and then they don't have to worry about it.
And like I said, you know, under housing first, you probably move them in without that mandate.
Yes.
And then when it's shown that doesn't work, then you come back and say, it ain't working. You know, we're gonna do something different. I've gotta come back to the late fees thing. You're going to hate me. But I have to say it. So, if you have a situation where you are the owner of the property and you are renting to program participants, HUD has a rule about no fees other than rent.
it is, in my opinion, a shipping up like a lot of their stuff. That means, it, again, if it's a if it's an independent landlord, you know, your tenant-based, renting the community, the landlord can charge a late fee. If your tenant, if his tenant loses, her tenant loses the keys, you can charge a lost key fee. If you own the real property and you're renting the tenant, you can't charge them a late fee.
That's
you,
good to know. It's been an
you
RV.
Can't charge them a lost key thing. You can't charge, you can, HUD's rules are, you can, if you are the director system, you can only charge them their 30, you know, their share of the rent. Their tenant rental payment, that's the only charge you can require them to pay. It's annoying.
So the more that comes out of your mouth, the more I'm getting like, oh,
it's annoying.
Gosh.
I'm sorry. That's a real
because
annoying.
Because our landlord does charge that.
I'm sorry?
Our landlord does.
Oh, well, if it's a landlord, it's okay. If it's a third-party landlord, it's okay. But doesn't really, let me be very clear about this. I'm talking about single-site things. So if it's a permanent supportive housing project, I own the building. I've got 20 units in the building. You know, I'm the nonprofit agency. I'm the HUD grantee. I also own that real property.
Oh.
You know, another side of my company is signed, you know, my, but it's
okay.
It's
that's
our
okay.
Building.
You're okay.
If that's the case, you know, I can, if I'm the direct recipient, I own the building, I can't charge other fees. If you got a third party, if it's, you know, an independent thing with the landlord follows their policies that they do that. Because that's okay. It's the program that
okay,
can't
yeah,
charge.
Yeah, we can't charge anything in the program anyways. Okay.
Yep.
I was
yep.
Like,
so the problem is it does come back and bite people who own the real property because it restricts what you can do. If you don't own the real property, then they can institute those charges. Yeah.
That doesn't include damage, right? Damage is to be assessed. The person punched a hole in the wall and has to be fixed. They charge $25, whatever it is to fix it. Is that allowed?
You're gonna hate me. I said, no, it isn't.
Oh, really?
No. I mean, we can get into it. What there is that there are some provisions. If you're using rental assistance, you could use some of that money to pay for damages that are caused by your tenant, but you normally can use it to pay for damages after the tenant's out of the unit. Yeah, exactly. But otherwise, you can't, you know, I mean, HUD, I think that they got really little because they wrote the regulations that say no fees can be charged to participants other than rent.
Maybe you can tell me